This madam has to respond. Sani?
Yes, ma'am.
Sani, you unmute, okay?
Unmute. Yeah, Mr. Sani.
Yeah, ma'am.
What did my video just tell me? Hey, this is another Google Meet and this one.
Lavina, madam, please unmute your mic. Unmute your mic.
Okay. Unmute, Kirajali.
Mute your mic, please. Mute your mic, yeah. Thank you. Sani, can you start?
Yes, ma'am. Hello, good morning everyone, present here with warm greetings. Alone, we can do so little. Together, we can do so much. All social workers are created different. Together, the differences form a harmony. Singing a well-orchestrated melody, the beauty is in the harmony. I, Sani Balkis, second year student from the Department of Medical Social Work, Enappoya, deem it to be university. I all heartily welcome to this webinar on medical social work scope of psychosocial interventions by Dr. Lavina Noronha. Welcome you, ma'am. On this occasion, I welcome the HOD, Dr. Mohammed Gudigar, all the faculty members and the participants for this webinar. Now, I invite Dr. Gladys Colasso, Assistant Professor, Department of Medical Social Work, who has a pivotal role in arranging this webinar, to welcome and introduce the speaker. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Sani. Respected guest speaker, faculty members, and dear participants, a very warm good morning to all of you. I'm glad to see you all joining online to participate in this webinar on medical social work, scope of psychosocial intervention. As you are aware, activities in all space in the country are at a standstill state due to COVID-19 pandemic. Education sector has been badly affected, especially the social work education. Students cannot be exposed for practical experience. The skills, techniques, and the methods of social work, which are learned theoretically, cannot be practiced. Hence, this webinar is an attempt to help the student to understand the psychosocial interventions in medical settings. It is a moment of great pleasure to extend a cheerful welcome to the faculty members and the students of the various social work colleges who are present in this webinar. I deem it a privilege to introduce and welcome the guest speaker of the day, a renowned personality, Dr. Lavina M. Noronha, Director, Ave Maria Palliative Care Center, Vamanjung, Mangalore. Graduated in psychology from St. Agnes College, Masters in Social Work from School of Social Work, Roshni Nilaya, MPhil in Psychiatric Social Work from NIMHANS, Bangalore, and PhD in Social Work from University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, USA. Dr. Lavina has many years of rich experience as an academician and clinician, has made the country round with her work. She has many publications to her credit. Her contribution as a resource person in many seminars is immense. With the strong attributes of training, she has trained students, teachers, nurses, social workers, employees, which cannot be numbered. A recipient of many awards and honors, Dr. Lavina is affiliated to many universities in India and abroad. I'm proud to say that she's affiliated as a guest faculty to Anupoya deemed to be university also. She is the founder director of Ave Maria Palliative Care and Sushiek Care Home. The Sushiek Lifeline, a helpline for suicide prevention, initiated by her towards providing telephonic counseling, is reaching out to people from all over India. With these words, I wholeheartedly welcome you, madam, to this webinar. I'm extremely happy to welcome Dr. Mohammad Guthigar, HOD of MSW Department, Dr. Irene Vegas, Assistant Professor, MSW Department of Anupoya deemed to be University, for this webinar. I extend a hearty welcome to Mr. Rajesh Karkera, Deputy Director of IT Department, and his team members who are with us for providing technical support without any glitch. I also welcome our department PhD scholars, Ms. Nasreen and Mrs. Mainaz, and all the non-teaching staff of the department to this webinar. Coming together is a beginning. Keeping together is a progress, and working together is a success. We all are a part of this institution due to our shared passion for the vision of the institution. Our passion unites us, and our hard work strengthens the institution. I'm sure you all will be enriched with more knowledge at the end of this webinar, which will throw more light on the psychosocial intervention in the field of medical social work. I cordially welcome all those who have just joined to us. Welcome one and all. Thank you.
Sani.
Thank you, Gaddis ma'am. Now you can start, ma'am.
Good morning, everyone. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we're going to start. I'm really privileged to present this topic to you. Thank you for the opportunity. Medical social work, scope of psychosocial interventions. That's the topic of today. Let's see how much we can cover today in a little more than 1 hour. Let's go back to the historical overview. How did it all begin? It started in the United States of America in the late 1800s, 1890s, when Dr. Charles Emerson, he was a medical doctor who envisioned the role of psychosocial aspects in the care of, in the diagnosis or etiology of medical illness, as well as in the treatment and care of medical illness. So he wanted the medical students to incorporate psychosocial aspects in their interventions. And he advocated for posting medical students in charity organizations. So he was the first one. And in 1905, Boston, Massachusetts Hospital was the first hospital to appoint a medical social worker in historically. In India, it is TISS, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, which pioneered in medical social work education and started training social workers to be placed in healthcare settings and to work as full-fledged medical social workers. Now, What exactly is medical social work? It is the application of the philosophy and principles of social work practice to healthcare. So whatever we do, you apply it to healthcare settings, hospital settings, clinic settings. Here I have used MSW, which means medical social work, not master of social work. So medical social work believes that health is a condition in which individual is capable of using his full potential for his or her well-being, which means when a person is functioning at the optimum level, the person is experiencing or the person has good health. So when there is ill health, when there is disease, when there is sickness, this functioning is affected. And the goal of medical social work is to bring the person back or to hoist the person back to the pre-illness level of functioning so that the person can stand on his or her own feet. So it incorporates a lot of psychosocial aspects of illness. Oops. Okay, treatment of an illness is not the final goal in social work, but a person's well-being and health is the final goal. We know, all of us know, that not all illnesses, not all diseases can be treated, can be cured. So there are some illnesses and diseases which have to be endured, which do not have a cure. So these illnesses do affect the quality of life of individuals. So when cure is not possible, when complete recovery is not possible, the goal is to take care of the quality of health of the individual so that the person can live a comfortable life with the disease. Not without the disease, but along with the disease. We have a lot of terminal conditions like COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, cardiac diseases, renal failure or CKD, chronic kidney disease, chronic liver disease. So these are all terminal conditions. Of course, cancer. So these are terminal conditions, most of which do not have cure. The person will have symptoms, will have to manage his or her life along with the symptoms. So make sure that the quality of life of the individual is not affected. So person with the illness is more important than the illness itself. As social workers, we have to remind ourselves and our fellow medical professionals or the medical fraternity that people are not diseases. Person is not a disease. So many times we see, we also get carried away when we are placed in hospitals, when we are placed in medical settings. What we do is we start labeling people. We start imitating the labels that are given. So-and-so is diabetic. So-and-so is a kidney patient. So we forget that there is a person behind the label. There is a person behind the diagnosis. So this is a clear-cut reminder to the social workers as well as other professionals that people have diseases, people have illnesses, but they are not diseases. So disease itself is not a diagnostic entity, not a label. So we have to bifurcate the individual from the symptomatology, from the illness or symptoms which are presented by the individual. So medical social work, therefore, is a powerful avenue towards comprehensive and qualitative health care. Biopsychosocial and cultural aspects have to be taken into consideration in nursing the person back to health, in nursing the person back to the optimum level possible of functioning. Not the 100% level, but as much as possible. So that's the goal of medical social work. We use a four-pronged approach. Like all other medical professions, there is prevention, treatment, aftercare, and rehabilitation. The social work interventions do not stop with treatment. There is aftercare and follow-up. So capacity building, enhancing resources is the goal to make sure the person is able to withstand the symptoms as much as possible with medical interventions, with psychosocial interventions. Enhancing a person's resources. Many times not having enough resources is a limitation for many individuals. So they don't seek treatment. They don't go to the doctors because of a lot of issues. And financial burden is the number one deterrent for seeking medical help. So what we need to do is we need to see how we can enhance these resources so that the people can receive the treatment. Many times we see there is poor drug compliance. Medical fraternity advises the patient and the families. They have to be on this medication for life, or maybe 6 months, maybe 2 years. But what happens is within 2-3 weeks, they get exhausted financially. Their resources are completely depleted. When this happens, there is a tendency to be non-compliant with medical regimen. They don't go for their dialysis. For example, if a person has kidney failure, renal issues, so they have to be dialyzed maybe once a week, sometimes twice a week, sometimes every day, depending on the level of their renal functioning. Without dialysis, the toxicity will build up and it could be lethal. It could result in death. So it is important. But dialysis itself has a lot of not just financial burden, but also there is physical discomfort and pain. It is an outpatient procedure or a daycare procedure, which means the patient has to be transported to the hospital or the healthcare facility or the unit where the dialysis, where the person is being dialyzed. So everyday transport, somebody has to accompany, because once the dialysis is over, the person is completely depleted of all his or her energy. So they cannot travel alone. They need to be accompanied by another family member or a caregiver. So it's important for the caregivers to accompany. And that's another reason why people don't comply with medical regimen, with dialysis. It's the same with chemotherapy and radiation. When people have cancer, when somebody is diagnosed with cancer, radiation and chemotherapy do not happen in one sitting. So there are 6 cycles, 8 cycles, 12 cycles of chemotherapy, which is delivered in over a period of time. So that cannot happen in hospital when they are admitted. So they have to be sometimes taken for outpatient chemotherapy treatment. Radiation treatment also is the same. So it is very easy for people to give up because of finances, because of not having enough resources to reach the healthcare facility, not having a caregiver who can accompany them to the healthcare facility. So we have to make sure that it's very easy for us to advise them, you have to do this, and if you do chemotherapy, you will get better. There are chances your cancer will completely be destroyed, and chemotherapy will be able to destroy your cancer cells. But we don't look at, so since the medical fraternity does not have the means or the time to look at all these issues, why is a patient non-compliant? Why does a patient does not follow through? Why do they stop taking medications? A lot of it has to deal with not having the resources. We need to make sure that they have resources. So capacity building, enhancing resources, building resilience. Every person is different. Every individual has a different level of stamina to withstand the illness. But everyone has the ability to cope with whatever symptoms, with medical help, with psychological assistance and social support. Understanding social and psychological influences in aftercare and rehabilitation. We come from, most of us are in joint family or extended family units even now. So extended family members also have to be taken into consideration. We cannot leave them out when we are doing a treatment plan. Otherwise, what happens is whatever is done in the hospital gets undone at home. Some family member will propose a different line of intervention, a different mode of treatment. For example, let's do Ayurvedic, let's do Unani. This is not a real illness. It's because of what our family has done in the past. So we need to understand the cultural issues which affect medical health. Also people's understanding of health and wellness, health and illness both. So we need to, rehabilitation and aftercare are two prongs which help people get back to the level of functioning which they were earlier. What are tools are needed in social work? First of all, assessment of patient's needs. Physical assessment, physiological assessment is done by the medical team and the nurses. Psychosocial assessment falls on the shoulders of the social worker. So, holistic assessment of a patient's need. What does this patient need so that the person will comply with medication and treatment? How does this person take the diagnosis? Is there emotional, are there emotional issues which have to be addressed? Without this, recovery is not possible. So assist both patients and the families in coping with a lot of, these are multiple issues, accompanying illness or inhibiting complete recovery. Evaluation of means. What does that mean? What kind of kinds of resources are available within the person's reach? Maybe family support, maybe network. What is the support system? Are there caregivers available? Is the person alone? How far does the person live from the medical facility? How does the person commute? Is there a transportation facility? Now, with the pandemic, we know that many people have fallen through the cracks because they don't have access to transport. They don't have their own means of transport, or whatever means of transport that are available are not within their reach because of economic reasons. So we need to evaluate the means. It is very easy for us. So you do this, you come and see me once a week. Is it possible for that person? How far does the person come from? How does the person commute? Is it possible for them to come alone? If it is a child, for example, you cannot expect a 10-year-old child to come on its own. So child has to be accompanied by a parent, which means foregoing a day's wages. One whole day it takes, because they have to commute from a far away distance and they come to the hospital and they cannot just finish their treatment or whatever follow-up session in 15 minutes or half an hour. Sometimes it takes a whole day. Sometimes they have to carry lunch. Sometimes they have to have money to have their lunch or coffee or tea. Sometimes they reach the hospital in the morning. Investigations and discussions and consultation and medical regimen takes a whole day. In the evening, how do they go back? So is the parent willing to forego a day's wages to be with the child? Can they afford to spend a whole day with the child? So that can sometimes is also responsible for non-compliance. And we need to understand these psychosocial issues. And it's very easy for us. Oh, people don't come for help. They don't understand. They are unscientific in their approach. But what is the reason for non-compliance? Why do they not come? So we need to look beyond all this and understand their support system which they have. Sometimes they can carpool. 2-3 people are going to the same hospital. Somebody is going to the skin department. Someone is going to gynecology unit. Somebody is going to oncology for follow-up. So they can carpool and share the expenses. So with that is not possible unless someone coordinates, because I will not know how many people from my village or from my community are planning to go to this hospital on a Thursday. So I need to talk to people. So social worker can do that, and social worker can coordinate that. Organization of community resources, if it is not possible. We have a lot of community resources. There are a lot of transport units available. Many times, you know, we have free ambulances available now, which was not possible. 500 rupees, 1000 rupees for one trip is not always possible for a family, for a middle class or even lower middle class family. So making use of these community resources is something social workers have to be aware of, what kind of resources are available. Advocating for free legislation, amendment of previous legislation. So not just taking care of people and their needs and taking care of their psychosocial issues and the treatment and intervention. Also, a medical social worker needs to understand what is the current legislation. How do these laws affect the person's health? What is the limit on medical treatments? How many radiation sessions can be given free of cost? What are the government programs and schemes available? Under which program can a person benefit? So all this, unless we know the availability of these schemes and programs, how many sessions after a break of 2-3 months, again you can apply and you can get qualify for 6 more chemo or radiation sessions. So all of this is possible only when the social workers are well informed about what is out there. Everyday things change. So if the programs are not reaching, for example, we have health insurance, we have disability insurance of 1,000 rupees, old age pension of 1,000 rupees. Now we know today we cannot live with 1,000 rupees. Elderly are on medication which costs a minimum of 3,000 rupees a month. But the government will not understand because they have not felt the pinch. So it is up to the social worker to advocate for this, for the patients. And with your meager 1,000, they have to skip their meals and take the medication. If they take the medication, then there is no money for rice and curry. So that is a reality for many elderly in our country. With 1,000, they cannot do anything. It's good that at least they are getting something, but that is really meager amount. Because just the blood pressure medication for a month costs about 300 rupees. Then they have multiple health issues, kidney issues, arthritis, joint pains. They need something to apply topically. So all this cannot be covered in their 1,000. So somewhere, whatever help that is available, even though there is legislation, there is social insurance, there is a medical security amount that is coming as disability, but that is not enough to make ends meet. So we need to advocate, we need to let the government know, let the lawmakers know, legislators know that these schemes are not reaching, that they are not enough. We need more, we need to do more for these people, and we need to reach out to these people in a better manner. Scope of MSW or medical social work is not limited to just medical settings, but also, now these are some of the medical settings: HIV AIDS units, obstetrics and gynecology, community medicine, oncology, pulmonary, renal and cardiac units, and geriatric units. These are all medical specialties or medical specializations where they can use the services of a social worker in order to make sure that people's holistic needs are met. What can you do? You assess the individual, holistic assessment of the person and his or her environment, so that you can communicate with the team. When the doctor says, okay, the person has to come every day for dialysis, what are the means available? Is the person able to come? How long does the person take? How long does it take for the person to reach from home to the hospital? What is the medical condition or health status of the individual? Is he able to sit for 3 hours, wait for 4 hours in the OPD or in the dialysis unit? Do they have a family member who can accompany them? So based on the means and social workers' assessment, the team can suggest a better approach. Maybe daycare, maybe admit the person and do the dialysis. And then in the evening, someone can come and pick them up instead of another person or the caregiver's time being wasted. So there are always alternatives so that people benefit from the interventions that they are advised. Counseling about the nature of illness. In order to counsel people, we need to know what kind of illnesses are out there. What does COPD mean? What does CVA mean? unless we open the files and ask questions, we don't know. If we don't know, we will not be able to educate family members. So it is wrong to give them false information. So in order to know, attend ward rounds. In fact, when you ask questions, the team members are more happier because you're showing an interest. If you go to the medical ward and sit there and waiting for someone to give you work, you will be sitting for a long time without anything. So it is important to reach out and ask questions. What can I do? I'm a social work intern. I'm a social worker who is appointed full time. And this is my role. I can do all these things. What does this mean? So during the ward rounds, you can ask questions. You can ask the nurses why a person is given certain things. What is the use of that medication? What are the side effects? Do your searches, do your literature search, do your research. Before you can meet with the family members and patients, it's important to know what is this illness? How long? What is the course of the illness? What is the prognosis? Will the person get better? Or is the prognosis poor? Will treatment bring the person back to the normal level of functioning? What are the side effects of all these treatments which are advocated? Honest communication about chemotherapy, radiation, dialysis, blood transfusion, heart transplant, renal transplant, all the interventions that are prescribed. So I need to know what exactly is going on. So when the family members and the patient ask me questions, I am able to answer. So there is trauma of accepting acute or chronic illness. When someone is diagnosed with something terminal, somebody has a cardiac issues, your 10-year-old has cancer, your mother will not live more than 6 months. So these are some of the issues patients as well as family members have to grapple with. Naturally, we don't want to accept the diagnosis or prognosis in one sitting. It is difficult because we always have second thoughts. Maybe it's a mistake. Maybe the medical lab made a mistake. Someone else's test results are given to me. I need to go for second opinion. I need to go for third opinion. Maybe I need to go to a different hospital. So they are second guessing. They want to make sure that the diagnosis is somehow wrong. So after second opinion and third opinion, when the diagnosis comes out the same, they have to accept. So they are in a state of shock. There is disbelief. There is anger. I'm a good person. I was a good person. Why did I get diagnosed with this? It is not possible to have this. I have, you know, I'm eating well. I'm healthy. I'm exercising every day. I take care of my health. But how is it possible? So there are some questions which don't have answers. And we need to give them some time to grapple with this trauma and just listen to them and allow them to, especially in counseling sessions, allow them to talk and express their emotions, their shock, their disbelief, their anger, their sadness, maybe guilt. Maybe I did this. I should not have done this. I should have known better. So there is sometimes guilt associated with diagnosis. So there are a lot of multiple emotions which are displayed by the patient as well as the family members. So counseling is also another approach of educating the family. This is what it is. We don't know what the outcome is. They are going to try. So there are chances you will get better. But there are chances maybe it will not be all right. So it's important to be honest about communication. Many times, medical fraternity does not allow you to be honest, but it is not right to deceive our patients. It's not right. It's against the social work principles. So at all times, you have to uphold social work principles. You have to make sure that they are not compromised. These ethics and values of human behavior are not compromised because of the approaches. So it's our role, it's our job to educate other professionals also. It is not the right thing. We need to tell them that person has 3 months to live so that the person can get ready. If we keep them in denial, if we keep them in the dark without telling them exactly what is going on, there is no way they can get ready. Sometimes people die without even saying goodbye to their loved ones. So we have to be more realistic in our approach and not always idealistic. It's good to cure everybody, but we have to be practical, pragmatic, and realistic. It's not possible to cure all illnesses. Some illnesses cannot be cured, no matter what you do. So it's important to communicate that. Give them the options of going through with the treatment or not going through with the treatment. And sometimes, you know, especially in terminal illness, you tell them to ask questions. If I do chemo, how long will I live? You teach them to ask these relevant questions. If I do not opt for chemotherapy, how long will I live? So sometimes there are clear answers. It is not possible to tell. Maybe you live 6 months. Without chemo, you live 3 months. Now, I know if I undergo chemotherapy, my life will extend by 90 days. If I don't opt for chemotherapy, my life will be cut short by 30 days or 90 days. So it is up to me to make a decision. Do I want to do it? So what is chemotherapy? What it does to my body? What chemotherapy does to the cancer cells in my body? What chemotherapy does to the good cells in my body? Will I have infections? What about nausea? What about pain? What about diarrhea? What about constipation? So 3 months of my life is extended, but there is no quality of life. I have extended my life, but it is not really a good life. So somewhere, if patients are educated honestly about what they are suffering from, what are the issues related to treatment, what are the adverse effects, then they can make an informed decision, and the family also will not feel guilty of making a decision not to go through with treatment. Third is legal assistance. Upholding patients' rights is important. We have this whole act about right to information, but when patients ask information, very few patients get information. Many times they are denied their right. So these legislations are available on paper, but in reality, why is this being done to my family member? What are the effects? What will happen? What are the consequences? What will it cost? So they have a right to know. So we need to advocate for these patients. We need to protect patients and their rights. So sometimes, especially in accident cases, there is legal involvement. What really happened? So we need to be, you cannot be value neutral, but if you have the information, it is important to uphold the values and give honest information to the legal system. Sometimes there is abuse and neglect of a patient. Sometimes there is misuse of resources. So we have to be guardians for these people, guardians of ethics for people in institutions. Sometimes a power of attorney is needed, or a legal guardian has to be appointed. In the case of a mentally challenged child, the child is not able to make decisions because the child is cognitively impaired to make a decision. Child will not know whether I should do this or no. In that case, if there is no family members available, the social worker needs to advocate to appoint a legal guardian, and the court appoints a legal guardian, and the legal guardian makes the decision for the child. Sometimes they appoint family members, provided the family members do not have vested interests. If this child dies, I will get all the resources or the property will come to me. So then the guardian has to be someone who will not benefit from life or death of this particular patient or the child. So somewhere, when even legal guardians are appointed, we have to be very careful that there are no selfish motives or vested interests of these guardians, which are driving them to be caregivers for the children. Advocacy is a mediation between patients and family. Be a mediator between patient and community also. We have to be a voice for the people and help them from falling through the cracks. What does it mean, falling through the cracks? Is they try once, they go to the medical, or they go to the government office, they stand in line, they have wasted their 3 days, they've not gone for work. Fourth day, they just give up. So they need to be accompanied by someone. Unless they are accompanied, they don't have a voice. Even if they have a voice, their voice is very feeble. And the bureaucrats will not listen to their voice. So that's where social worker comes in handy. You can accompany them and you can make sure that they don't fall through and they really receive the help that they deserve through the system. Fifth one is care planning. Planning for the care of the individual, holistic care of the individual. When the person is in the hospital, what is needed? Food arrangements, financial arrangements. If the person is a breadwinner of the family, what is going to happen to the family? What will be the cost of treatment? Can they afford to take care of the person at home? Does the home have hygienic environment? Sometimes, you know, there are chances of infection. Sometimes even in the hospital or in, you know, especially after CVA or cerebrovascular accident or a stroke, people are totally immobile. They are bedbound. And when they are bedbound, they are bound to develop pressure sores or bed sores. So many times, unless you turn them every 2 hours, these pressure sores can get infected. And people don't die of stroke, but they die of the consequences of a stroke and sometimes of pressure sores. So we need to make sure that the resources are available at home to lift or shift these individuals, to change their positions every so often so that they don't develop bed sores. If air mattresses or water beds are available, you advocate for them. If they don't have the means, there are a lot of NGOs which provide these means, wheelchairs, supports, commodes, all these, walkers. So there is a social worker can be a mediator between the community resources and the patient and his or her family, and make sure that these resources are utilized by the family. They reach the deserving candidates. There are a lot of financial assistance available, especially certain treatment costs are borne by the government. Not everyone has insurance in our country. Not everyone has private insurance. So there are some schemes. Sometimes people are not aware of ESI benefits and other schemes which are available. How many family members are covered? Ex-army, they have ECHS services. So if a family member, the breadwinner, was in the army and retired, so dependents are covered under ECHS scheme. So with ECHS, you can get free hospitalization and a lot of treatment benefits, free medications every month, follow-up care and all that. Transport and such things are not given. But there are services available and we have to be aware that these are available for the patients. School help or placement. There are hostels available. If you come to know when you do a home visit now, we don't do home visit now because of the pandemic. It's not possible. But we can always try, we can always reach out to people so that we can study them in their own environment. Unless I go and visit a person in his or her home, I will not know what exactly is going on the home front. So if there is a need for placement, maybe school fee help or anything else, that can also be arranged by the social worker. Now, social workers do all this. Where can you be employed? In medical settings, hospitals, long-term care facilities. They are not going to get better, but they will be there for a long time. Rehabilitation center. After a physical disability, they need physiotherapy. They need exercise regimen. They need a lot of support. So they cannot be at home. They need everyday physiotherapy, maybe speech therapy after a stroke. So there are rehabilitation centers. Home health is gaining momentum now because people prefer to be treated. So the team, many hospitals have a team which visits patients in their own homes. There is a doctor, there is a nurse, there are lab technicians, they can draw blood, blood pressure can be monitored, vital signs can be monitored. The nurse can make sure that the medications are being taken, that they don't have any other adverse effects of the medications. So the team goes to the patient's home, and in the comforts of a person's home, they receive healthcare services. But so most of the hospitals charge patients for these services, and insurance, many insurances do not cover home help. So unless people have means, they cannot afford home help. So sometimes health assistants or health home care nurses are appointed to take care of patients when the loved ones or caregivers are not available. Aftercare facilities, hospices or end-of-life care centers, you can, social workers can give caregiver support, community education, this can do case management, discharge planning, in geriatric or gerontology units, they can work with the elderly and their family members, make sure that the elderly are not being neglected or abused. If they are, it can be brought to the attention of the elderly abuse hotlines. Same thing with children. When you visit a home, you will know that the child is neglected or abused. If you come to know, you can take action. The child can be placed in a comfortable or a more conducive environment so that the child is not physically, sexually, or emotionally abused. In administration, management, specialized health care clinics also, social workers can be employed. Holistic view of the patient is very important. Collect and
dear participants, please wait for a moment. The resource person lost the connection. She will rejoin. Please be patient. Thank you. Dear participant, please wait in patience. So within 2 minutes, she will connect. Please bear with us.
Flourished into a full-fledged university, providing training in medicine and all its parallel fields. Currently, Yenapoya is a dynasty of educational institutes like Yenapoya Dental College, Medical College, Nursing College, Physiotherapy College, Yenapoya Pharmacy College and Research Center, and Yenapoya Institute of Arts, Science, Commerce and Management were further established to offer education and research in the areas of pharmacy, management and general education. Yenapoya offers a plethora of courses with 89 ongoing and 20 approved and proposed programs. The PhD program has been introduced in 39 departments and research center as per the UGC regulations. The medical college also offers undergraduate courses in technical programs like medical lab technology, medical imaging technology, perfusion, renal dialysis, anesthesia and OT, cardiovascular technology, respiratory care, optometry, as well.
This one?
Madam, we can't see.
All the constituent colleges are provided with excellent infrastructure to impart knowledge. Spacious examination halls and 19 lecture halls have the electronic support system to engage students eloquently. Practical training is complemented with well-equipped laboratories. The anatomy dissection hall introduces students to the intricacies of the human body before undertaking clinical examinations and procedures. Well-equipped pathology and biochemistry lab foster the importance of diagnostic procedures to implement treatment. The central laboratory is a key unit, conducts number of diagnostic and confirmatory tests. Many significant in vivo researches are conducted at the Animal House of Pharmacology Lab. At the Nursing Nutrition Lab, aspiring students learn to put together a nutritious meal for the benefit of their wards. Pre-clinical exercise at the Physiotherapy Lab enhances clinical understanding. Dental simulators prepare students to handle clinical scenarios. The simulation center at Yenapoya is the largest in India.
Okay, collect and analyze patients' information, help the professionals in the team understand what is going on. And also there are a lot of social, emotional, environmental factors which are underlying a patient's condition. So unless we find out this information and relay this information to the health professionals, to the team, they will not understand. So it's important to collect all the information, whether the person is able to comply, what are the living conditions, how far does a person has to come from in order to come for a follow-up. So all this and how many members are available? Is there privacy in the person's room? Will the person be comfortable in the home or are they hygienic living conditions? All these have to be analyzed and relayed back to the team. A lot of emotional and social components of the illness. So there is a lot of stigma attached to terminal illness, being diagnosed with HIV or AIDS. What did I do? Maybe I'm a good person. How did I get this illness? Same thing with cancer. We need to understand the cultural underpinnings of medical illness. Even the cancer diagnosis, for example, many people are not willing to accept. So people go from clinic to clinic, hospital to hospital, lab to lab in order to find out whether they really have cancer. Maybe my biopsy is wrong. Maybe someone else's lab results report is given to me. So there is a lot of stigma attached to being diagnosed with cancer. These are a lot of emotional components. There is anxiety and fear. What lies ahead? What's going to happen? I am the breadwinner. What will happen to my family? Will they be able to afford treatment?
If they spend money on my treatment, how are they going to make ends meet? So many families sometimes forego their comforts in order to afford, in order to undergo treatment or continue with the treatment regimen. So there is sadness associated. All of a sudden our life has changed because of this illness. There is anxiety. There is uncertainty about future. Will it get better? What will happen to the economic status of our family? What will happen to the finances? What will happen to children's education? So there is helplessness, confusion, many times self-evaluation, not only in the patients, but also with the family members. So we have to address this. Social isolation also. People are isolated from others. So sometimes people feel that if we visit them, we don't know what to say. So they are estranged from family members. Maybe they'll ask for financial help. So it's better to stay far away from these families. So some families are very, very close-knit. They will come forward to assist in any way possible, emotionally or as well as physically. But some families shy away or move away from helping each other in terms of crisis. So they are all alone. So that brings about a lot of social isolation. They are isolated from the community because of the illness. So and so has this particular illness. Now with the pandemic, we understand because it is contagious, but even when it comes to cancer, sometimes people are not even able to say, somebody has a big illness. They don't tell you what kind of illness they have. So these emotional, psychological, social, cultural components of the illness also have to be understood so that we can educate the family members about illness as well as treatment options. If they are close-minded, if they have their own understanding, no, I think we will not do treatment. We can do some faith healing. So many times people say, no need of chemotherapy. So sometimes people wait for a long time. They go from pillar to post looking for different kinds of cures, which are not really scientific. But when you stop them, they will not, it's not possible to understand why they do what they do. So it's okay for them, but you also introduce your understanding of treatment. You can try this. You do your prayers, you do your faith healing, you do all those, but also try this. Maybe it might work. So somewhere we need to educate the communities, educate patients and families about their understanding of the illness. Terminal illness. There is a need for direct and ethical communication. We need to be honest about the diagnosis. It's important for the person to know what the person is ailing from, what the person needs to do, how long do they have, what is the prognosis of the illness. It's important for the family members to know what kind of treatments are being recommended, what are the side effects, and based on all this information, they can make an informed decision. It's important because we have to uphold the social work ethics and principles at all times. We also need to educate other professionals to uphold medical social work ethics and values. Avoid false assurance. It's just a small cyst. We will remove the cyst and you will be all right. If it is a small cyst, then why am I being taken to the radiation ward? Why am I being given this concoction of chemotherapy? And if it is a cyst, if I'm all right. So sometimes some people ask questions. Some people don't have the wisdom to ask these questions. So they go with medical professionals. All of a sudden, people tell them, it's okay, there is nothing we can do. We've done everything we can. You take them home and the person will die very soon. You never told us that he was going to die. She was going to die. We could have been prepared. So it's important to emotionally and psychologically prepare the family for prognosis. If the prognosis is poor, if the prognosis is good, if it is 50-50, if it is 75-25, they have a right to know and we have a duty to let them know what exactly is going on. No person has died of heart attack listening to their, hearing their diagnosis. No family has committed suicide because of the diagnosis. We need to give credits to people. There is resilience. People are resilient. People are strong. They can withstand ups and downs of life. We cannot undermine their capacities, but they have a right to know so they can prepare. Many times, you know, sometimes person is admitted to the hospital and the person is sinking. Even when the person is sinking, the community will not tell the children in the family. They only know that ambulance came and took father to the hospital. And all of a sudden, they bring the dead body home. Even though the family knew that he was sinking, they had a 1 week time to educate the children. So instead of shocking the family members, especially young children, it's important to tell them that your father is very sick. There are chances he may not come back alive, so that they can be emotionally and psychologically prepared for the end, prepared for the consequence, prepared for death of their father or loved one. They would want to know, I want to meet him. I want to say something to him. So we can give them these opportunities if we tell them. If we don't tell them, all of a sudden, they're in a state of shock. And grieving and mourning takes a long time, and it's a challenge when we don't prepare them. What can medical social worker do in the terminal ward? Crisis intervention with patient and family, because they are in a state of crisis because of the symptoms, because of what's going on. They are not able to digest the diagnosis. It's going to take some time. They are not ready for the prognosis, which is very dubious, which is not very good. So we have to allow them. Beliefs about illness and cancer, psychosocial, cultural beliefs. Nature and course of the illness, how long will it take? Discussion of treatment option. If I do chemo, how long will I live? If I don't do chemo, how long will I live? Is chemotherapy the only option? Is radiation the only option? Is surgery necessary? With surgery, what's going to happen? Without surgery, what's going to happen? We need to educate family members as well as patients to ask the right questions. And when they ask the right questions, they are more likely to get answers. And based on the responses, answers that they have received, they can make decisions whether to undergo, whether to continue with treatment or to terminate treatment. Whether to do surgery, whether to undergo surgery or dialysis or not to do it. Will transfusion help? How many bottles of blood? How many units of blood? Will that improve the person's quality of life? These are 6 steps in crisis intervention, which can be used in any terminal diagnosis. Establish a positive relationship with the person. They have a lot to ask. They have a lot to say. They have a lot of emotions to express. All we have to do is allow them to express these emotions. Elicit and encourage expression of painful emotions, like shame, guilt, maybe I did something wrong, anger, other people are better than me, I should not have done this, people who don't have illness, I'm angry with them. Discuss any precipitating event, which is the diagnosis which causes emotional discharge. Assess and prioritize their needs. What are the strengths available? What are the resources available within their family? What kind of resources will they need from the community, from non-government organizations? Provide support, intervention, enhance their cognitive functioning. Their thought processes are not right. They are in a state of shock. In a state of shock, they cannot think straight. They cannot make right decisions. So they need a lot of support in making decisions. And finally, this is brief crisis intervention. Once the crisis is over, family will pick up the pieces and move on. But in a state of crisis, they need a lot of help. So when a social worker is available to take them through the crisis, and they are able to withstand the emotional upheavals a lot better, and they can make right decisions, they can think straight. Social worker can be a mediator between the medical professionals and the family and the patient. How much of information needs to be collected? How much of information needs to be delivered to the family members? What will happen if I tell the family members about all this? So we need to prepare them. We need to be prepared for their emotional expressions also, so we can make decisions. Addressing reservation treatment options. Many times surgery is not one option. Sometimes, you know, surgery will not be therapeutic. Surgery will not improve the quality of life. Surgery will not take away the cancer completely. Is it needed? What are the consequences? If a person has 1 month to live, if the hemoglobin level is 6.0, will the person be able to withstand surgery? So many times hemoglobin level also is an indicator for chemotherapy. Chemotherapy is not advisable when the person cannot withstand, because it's a very strong cocktail of medications. Unless the body is able to withstand chemotherapy, chemotherapy can also be disastrous. So just because somebody is paying, government scheme is available, we cannot start them on chemotherapy. And if that is being done, we need to intervene and we need to make sure that this is not done, because whatever time a person has left can be cut short because of wrong decision making. Prosthesis after surgery, and there is disfigurement. What's going to happen psychologically? And for example, a woman with breast cancer, both breasts are removed because both are cancerous. So what's going to happen to her self-esteem? What's going to happen to her womanhood? Is prosthesis necessary? Is it needed? Is cosmetic surgery needed? Will reconstruction bring about improved self-esteem? Chemotherapy and radiation also have a lot of adverse effects and cause a lot of disability in the individual. They're not able to walk. Sometimes chemotherapy or radiation causes sometimes illness related, sometimes treatment related disability and symptoms. Hair loss, nausea, lymphedema, swelling, renal problems, infections, proneness for infections, excruciating pain. All these are some of the side effects. Grief counseling is something we need to do in medical units, because not all illnesses have cure. Not all family members will take their loved ones alive back home. So they need to, we have to use Elizabeth Kubler-Ross's, understand the stages of grief people go through: denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. It's not easy to accept what's going on. They will go back and forth from denial and being angry and start bargaining, being irritable, feeling sad, feeling upset, feeling helpless. So we need to understand these stages and what people go through and accompany them through these emotional states. Address guilt if there is guilt. I should not have done this. I was drinking too much. I was not a good father. I was not a good provider. I knew this was going to happen, but I did not change my lifestyle. So sometimes people blame themselves. Sometimes family members feel guilty for not taking care of their loved one. We should not have done this. We could have done something else. So there are shoulds and oughts and all these things which make their emotional, which make grieving a bit of a challenge. So we need to address their emotions. There is neglect and abuse. Sometimes caregivers are abusive towards the patient, not because of what the patient is doing or saying, but because they are frustrated. We need to understand rituals of grieving, even though they don't have meaning for us. Every culture, every religion has different grief rituals. Only when they go through these rituals, they will be able to grieve better, grieve in a healthy manner. So even though we don't understand, we cannot stop them from grieving or stop them from entertaining or engaging in these rituals and practices. There is a reactivation of grief during festivals, birthdays, anniversaries and stuff. So we need to address that too. And family counseling. Families also go. Yes,
madam, we are not able to see the slides. You have to represent, I think.
From which slide?
Last slide. Just now, which you are talking about.
Family counseling?
No, before that. Represent it, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, are you able to see now?
No, ma'am.
Now?
Not yet, ma'am. Not yet.
Okay.
So you have to go to the option present. Present now.
Okay.
From there you have to present. It is not possible, it is okay, ma'am. Okay, it is presenting now.
Is it okay? Can you see it now?
No, ma'am. Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes.
Okay, this same slide, right?
This is over. Yeah, this is over.
Okay, you are able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
So we'll go to the next one then. Okay, family counseling. Family emotions, hopelessness, there is helplessness, fear, anxiety. Families also go through a lot of sadness. They start grieving in anticipation. So there is something called anticipatory grief, which is a good thing because people can start grieving even before the person is, even when the person is alive. So this happens in terminal illness. Reaching out to siblings when a child has medical conditions. So sometimes when a child has a medical condition, something which is very serious, something which warrants the parents to be with that child all the time, to take the child for follow-up visits, for medication, for hospitalizations every now and then. It's very easy to for the siblings to get lost emotionally and also in reality what happens is siblings are neglected. Not intentionally, but unintentionally. All the parental attention is on one child who has a medical illness. So children, siblings feel that because I don't have the illness, I am being not cared for. I am being neglected. So it's important to bring these siblings to the mainstream to understand what's going on with the siblings. We see a lot of emotional and behavioral disturbances in siblings who do not have illness. When there is a child who has a medical condition. So these children are just acting out in order to get some attention. So they need a lot of help, emotional help and support. So they need to be incorporated, involved in counseling also. Transport arrangements, we talked about this earlier, financial burden on the family. What happens to the family? Sometimes children start feeling jealous about the child who has a medical condition. All the money, all the attention, all the resources are being used for one child. And we are not getting what we really deserve. So that is not okay for them. They cannot sacrifice their comforts for the sake of another sibling because they are also very young. They need a lot of attention. So parents need to understand this and parents have to be educated about what is the impact of illness on the siblings who do not have an illness. End-of-life decisions like organ donation, body donation, cremation, burial, all this talk has to happen when the patient is still alive. If we wait for the patient to die and then the family is running in all different directions and people are not able to help them. So it's up to the medical social worker to prepare the family well in advance so that they can make decisions about these body donation, organ donations, cremation, burial, life support, whether to opt for ventilator support, how long to opt for ventilator support, whether we have the economic means for ventilator support. Is it really needed? So all these decisions have to happen, all this discussion has to happen when the patient is still alive. And when the person dies, the family is psychologically and financially ready for the eventuality. Heart and renal transplant, a lot of pre and post transplant counseling will help people make decisions. Who are the family members who are coming forward to test? Many times there is hesitation among family members. If I give one of my kidneys, I'll be left with one. So sometimes other family members make them feel guilty. Sometimes they are good, they are considered to be the right donors. They have the same blood group, they have good health status, but they are in hesitation. What happens to me? Will I recover from this surgery completely? So these are some of the issues which have to be addressed in counseling sessions. Also, we need to know what happens after the renal transplant to the recipient as well as to the donor. Who is the right donor? Especially if it is a family member. If it is an outsider, so we have a lot of scams and financial rackets along associated with transplant. So we should stop these things from happening because nobody can sell their body parts. So these rackets have to be stopped at the before they become widespread. So these are some of the things which can be addressed by social workers if they are well informed. An MSW in the ICU unit has to be aware about all these medical conditions. COPD, CVA, heart diseases, kidney disease, renal failure, burns, food poisoning, stroke, sepsis, pneumonia. Unless I know what they mean, what they entail, what exactly happens in the ICU, I will not be able to educate the family members. So it's important to educate ourselves about these medical conditions so we are in a better position to answer family members' questions. There is crisis of medical diagnosis in all of this. No one is prepared for a stroke. When stroke happens, you have to immediately make decisions. You have to make arrangements. You have to take the family member to the hospital. And in the hospital, you're not really ready for a lot of other decisions, or there is a need for making drastic decisions. So there is uncertainty about future, whether to take them to the, put them on life support or no. Assist family members with their emotional expression. So MSW, I don't know whether all the hospitals appoint MSWs in ICUs, but intensive care unit is one place where a social worker can definitely help patients and family members. Many times I remember one family member telling me the only opportunity I got to talk to the doctor was when he was removing his footwear to enter the ICU. There is no eye contact. I would ask him questions and he would, as he's taking his shoes off and socks off and he's wearing the ICU slippers, that was the only occasion I saw the doctor. So sometimes this happens because we have very warped patient-doctor ratio. They cannot afford to sit with the patient for 3 hours and answer all their questions. This is where social worker can answer their questions and social worker can be a mediator and assuage their anxiety and bring them more comfort. HIV AIDS unit also seen. Yes?
I think time is getting over. 12:30 is end time. I think you can conclude if 1-2 persons.
Okay. Should I stop here?
Yeah, they can ask the question. Participants, if you have any questions other than the present, what is presented now, you can raise the question. The feedback form is also pasted in the chat box. You can fill that form. There is 5 minutes time. Please raise your question. You can put it in the chat box. Sorry, madam.
No problem.
How many more slides are there, madam?
I think there are 10 more slides.
Okay. Psychosocial intervention.
But I can do the important ones.
Yes.
Are you able to see this psychosocial interventions?
Yes.
Okay, there is psychoeducation and counseling. We talked about involve family members and caregivers. Group therapy we can do with a lot of people. People who are waiting for transplant, they understand each other's anxiety well. So 4 people can be put together and you can do supportive or even behavioral interventions to bring down their anxiety level. Stress management techniques are something which are very useful in medical social work. Communication skills, of course, you have to be a good communicator so that you would give the accurate information to the patient and their family members and not false information. You should know how to talk to the doctors too. Marital counseling, because one person has a spouse has medical illness, it has an impact on the spouse. So sometimes marriage is at stake and they have a lot of tensions in their marriage. So marital counseling also helps. A lot of self-help books are available. There are some hospitals have patient clubs where they informally patients interact with each other. So sometimes caregivers get together and talk. So when the caregivers are sitting together, so it doesn't have to be organized formal group, but informally when the patient party is talking, that is a good opportunity to address some of their questions and concerns. And also educate them about the illness as well as side effects and treatment options. Burnout prevention and medical staff. Many times people don't mean to be short with us. People don't mean to be nasty, but sometimes because of the workload, every day people see death. And that has an impact on the psychological well-being of medical staff. So as social workers, you can bring the staff together and address their concerns also. Because when the staff are happy, when the caregivers or professionals who are working with patients are happy and at peace, they will be able to better deliver their services and they will be able to reach out to the patients in a better manner. There is something called caregiver stress also. Caregivers burn out very easily because they are taking care of the patient all the time. So caregivers also need a lot of support. They suffer from sleep problems, anxiety, depression. They cannot eat. They have weight loss issues. They neglect self-care and they are taking care of the patient all the time. So it's important to give them a break to also educate them about taking care of themselves. If you take care of yourself, you will be able to take care of your family member. That is the principle. So caregiver burnout is a real thing in medical settings. So they can be supported with peer support groups, guidance, information, recreational opportunities. You can do recreational groups for the caregivers. Give them respite. I will sit with your loved one. You can just move out of the hospital and go for a walk for some time and I can sit with your patient for 10 minutes or 15 minutes. Doesn't have to be a whole day. So ask them if there is a family member who can replace them for one day instead of being with the patient for 3 months all the time. 24/7 the patient is taking is being cared for by the caregiver, so little break will help. Post discharge role, we already talked about this. Making arrangements for wheelchairs, prosthetic limbs, walkers, any equipment that will make their post discharge stay in the at home a comfortable one. Medical equipment is available, maybe shoes or braces or support system. Sometimes patients are not aware of these facilities. So how to make sure that they can reach them. Rotary clubs, Lions clubs sometimes help in distributing these prostheses also, wheelchairs and walkers and other equipments which are needed. But making them aware that this help is available, who is the local Lions Club? How can Rotary Club help? So we have a lot of community resources which can be used. The last slide is about lack of awareness. There is still lack of awareness about the role of a medical social worker. Many hospitals, social worker is considered to be a clerk. So they do a lot of clerical work. So because there is stigma attached to medical social workers also, because they are advocating for family members, advocating for the poor patients, and the people feel that, hospitals feel that they propagate charity care in which interferes with the business model of the hospitals. They advocate for non-paying patients all the time who are financially a burden, and they are nothing but clerks. So professional dominance and turf battles sometimes. You are a social worker, I'm a doctor, I'm a nurse, this is your job, this is my job. So sometimes there is conflict among team members about each other's roles. So that could be a challenge. Unless the medical fraternity is aware of the psychosocial issues, every opportunity we get, we need to teach people who are in the team, who are on the team, about the psychosocial genesis of medical illness and its management, without which complete recovery is not possible. So totally, we have to revitalize medical social work and realize the value of a social worker in medical settings so that we can claim our role. And we can reach out and make people recover from whatever illnesses, improve their quality of life for as long as they are in the hospital and even thereafter. Thank you very much. I think I have taken a little bit more time than which was allotted.
Yes, yes madam, it was a beautiful presentation. Sorry, I think we can continue for the vote
yes,
of
thanks. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your excellent presentation. It was an interesting section and also very informative. And participants, you can ask your questions directly to the speaker or else you can paste it in the chat box. And also, participants, please fill in the feedback form pasted in the chat box to receive your e-certificate.
Any questions from participants? No questions?
Okay, now it's time to conclude the webinar. I welcome Mr. Zain Jeffrey, second year student from the Department of Medical Social Work. Over to you, Zain.
Thank you, Sani. Good afternoon, everyone. I feel honored and fortunate to have the opportunity to propose the vote of thanks on this eventful occasion. On behalf of MSW Department of Anapoya deemed to be university, I would like to express my gratitude to all delegates and participants for your contribution and presence for making this webinar a memorable one. I would like to thank Anapoya deemed to be university for giving us the opportunity and support to have this webinar. I would like to extend my gratitude to our honorable resource person, Dr. Levina Narona, for acquainting us about the scope of psychosocial intervention. Thank you, ma'am. I thank Dr. Mohammed Kudiga, Head of Medical Social Work Department, Anapoya deemed to be university, for the support, encouragement, and for initiating this webinar. I also extend my gratitude to Dr. Gladys Colasso, Assistant Professor, MSW Department, for the coordination of this webinar. And I am thankful to Dr. Irene Vegas, Assistant Professor, MSW Department, for lending support. Thank you. I must thank all the faculties, staff, and my friends here at Anapoya University, and students of all the social work colleges who participated in this webinar. Thank you all. I would like to thank Ms. Fatima Zohra for all the assistance to organize and manage this webinar. Thank you. I thank my fellow classmate, Ms. Sani Balkis, for comparing this event. Thank you, Sani. And we are grateful to the IT department of Yenapoya deemed to be university for the assistance and support. Finally, I would like to thank you one and all for the effort, contribution, and participation for making this webinar a memorable experience. Thank you and have a good day.
Thank you, Zain Jeffrey. So we are really thrilled by your overwhelming response to this webinar. Hope you all are finished your feedback form. So webinar is over. Have a good day and looking forward to meet in the next webinar of similar kind. Thank you.
Dr. Lavina, madam, it was a good presentation. Very informative.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Yeah. And I think the students can make use of the intervention, what you have mentioned, psychosocial intervention, so that in their practice, when they are working in the hospital with the medical patients, mainly with terminally ill patients, I think these are the psychosocial interventions they can plan and do it. So thank you so much for the wonderful session.
Thank you, Dr. Lavina.
I think the issue is how to build the competence of social workers and social work trainees. That is the issue. Because you have got lot, you shared lot of points and also the factors. So I wish this to be put into action. So I think we have to give some thought to that.
Thanks a lot, ma'am, Lavina, ma'am. It was very
welcome.
Good.
Welcome.
Thanks a lot. It was useful for the medical social work also. Was very good beginning part also. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Which flourished into a full-fledged university, providing training in medicine and all its parallel fields. Currently, Yenapoya is a dynasty of educational institutes like Yenapoya.